What up, YouTube? It's your boy, I'm back again. Lord, it's been a minute. It's your boy, T-Boogie, back on another Sabbath day, coming to give you another lesson. Always good to be before God's people. So to my brothers and sisters in the faith, I salute you. Praise, all praise, honor, and glory due to the Most High God of Israel, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. The title of today's lesson is Mark for Life or Mark for Death. Because in this spiritual battle, this spiritual warfare that we're engaged in, you're either going to be in the Father's kingdom or you're going to be in the kingdom of Satan. You're either going to be God or you're going to be something else. I don't know what they're going to call you. But you're either going to have eternal life or you're going to have eternal death. So, you know, like I said, the title of today's lesson is Mark for Life or Mark for Death. And, you know, we all will be sanctified one way or another. Sanctified in the good side of the kingdom or sanctified to the bad side of the kingdom. We will either be proven worthy or proven unworthy. Will we be raised unto life or raised unto eternal damnation? What we do with this word of God pretty much seals the deal where you're going to spend eternity. Because we all going to live forever. But we're going to show you through God's word that this word is what's going to sanctify you to the good side of the kingdom. And if you follow this word and you do this word, you're going to be marked for life. Because, you know, this thing, everybody think that Satan's only one going to have a mark on his people. You know, we're talking about taking that mark of the beast. But we're going to show you through the word of God that God also marks his servants. And those who God have marked and set aside for his purpose and his will, those are the ones who are going to be marked for eternal life. But we ain't going to keep it prolonged. We're going to get right into the lesson. The first scripture is Revelations chapter 20. And we're going to read verses 11 through 13. Then we're going to skip down to 15. Revelations 20. We're going to start at verse 11. And I read. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. So right there, it's telling you there's going to be a judge. So learning something on our way to learn something. He said the dead were judged out of those books. So if you're going to be judged, how can you already be in heaven or in hell? Well, no, we got other lessons. You know, we talk about that at Lent. You know what I'm saying? But that ain't part of it. I just want to throw that out there. You know, you got to stand before judgment. So I don't think we don't serve a vain God. He ain't going to put you in heaven, put you in hell, then turn around the last day, judge everybody. Then, okay, well, you know, you go here, you go. No. But anyway, it said there was a great white throne and the people were judged according to the things that were in those books, your works. So you're going to get your reward according to what you do with the word of God. How you deal with the word of God. If you're going to church on the first day of the week or the seventh day of the week. If you eating pig meat, if you ain't eating pig meat. Are you honoring your mother and your father? These are the things that, didn't he say the books was open? That's what the word Bible means. Biblos mean a binding of books. You're going to be judged according to the things that was in this book or these books. Your works. And, you know, people say, you know, I'm saved by grace. I ain't got to do nothing. But right here, we just read in the New Testament, at the end of the New Testament, you're going to be judged according to your works. So, once again, breaking up untruth, providing truth, and uncovering lies. Verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. Talking about the grave. Now, this ain't talking about because Satan don't have no dominion. Satan's only dominion is this earth. God said he's the God of this world. And he even told you in Job, he asked Satan where he came from. And Satan said from up and down the earth and walking to and fro in. So it ain't talking about hell like he down at barbecue. He talking about the grave. He said death and hell gave up them that which were in it. Okay, continuing. And they will judge every man according to their works. Again, according to your works. And whosoever is not found, skipping down to verse 15. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast in the lake of fire. So if your name ain't in that book, you're going in the lake with the snake. You see what I'm saying? So once again, showing that separation between are you marked for life or are you marked for death? Because some people's name was marked down, written down in this book of life. You see what I'm saying? So there it is right there. Well, we're going to keep it moving. We're going to keep it moving. And, you know, your obedience to the word of God is the only thing that's going to get you, you know. And don't let nobody take your crown telling you you ain't got to do nothing. Jesus Christ paid it all. You know, we under grace. That's garbage. You know, like I said, we got other lessons, you know, to teach you what grace really is. You know, they done screwed that up too. But we got other lessons to show you that. So don't let nobody take your crown. You have to be obedient to the word of God. You know, he said that even then he told you, didn't he tell you, they have all not obeyed the gospel. So that means you got to obey something. They want to run over the Romans, talking about we're saved by grace, this, that, and the third. But they ain't tell you, they just keep reading and say, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. So you got to obey something. You know, what are you obeying? But anyway, that's another lesson. Let's look at some of the ways. We're just going to look at some of the ways that the Lord identifies his servants. We're going to go to Exodus. We're going to go to Exodus 12. We're going to do a little reading in Exodus. So we got quite a few scriptures, so you might want to put your mark in Exodus. Because we're just going to look at some of the ways the Lord identifies his servants, how he sanctifies and identifies his servants. We're going to Exodus 12. Exodus 12. And we're going to pick this thing up at verse 11. And we're going to read. I'm sorry. We're going to pick it up at verse 3. We're going to pick it up at verse 3. Now, I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to change it up. Let's go to Exodus 12. Let's go to Exodus 12. We're going to pick it up at verse 3. Okay. We're going to pick it up at verse 3. Then we're going to skip down and read verses 6 and 7. Then we're going to skip a little bit more. All right. So we're going to pick it up at verse 3. Exodus 12 and verse 3. This is what it says. Speak unto the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take unto them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And this is God, he's getting ready to institute the Passover. But let's skip down to verse 6. We're going to read verses 6 through 7. And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same day of the month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein they shall eat it. Now, this, like I say, this is Lord starting up the Passover. Excuse me. And he's getting ready to institute this Passover. He finna come through and he finna kill all the firstborn in Egypt. No, he finna kill all the firstborn in Egypt. But he told Moses, look, tell him to get this lamb and put this blood on their doorpost, a mark, a sign. Okay, that's a mark and a sign that, hey, and when I see this blood, I'm going to pass over them. Okay, let's skip down to verse 12. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be for you for a token. There it is, a sign. The blood shall be for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. There he is again. And it's just like now, when you come up under the bond of the covenant with Jesus Christ, you know, you profess him, you keep them laws, statutes, and commandments, and you go up under that water, he said, it's just like the blood covering you. He said, I ain't going to see you. I ain't going to see your sin. I'm going to see the blood. But you still got to do something. See, then them folks had to believe. They still had to believe enough to do something. They had to kill the lamb exactly how the Lord told him to kill the lamb on the day that the Lord told him to kill the lamb, and then they had to put the blood on the doorpost. They still had to do something. But like the book say, faith without works is dead. I believe, you don't do nothing. You don't believe because you ain't did nothing. But you just saw that blood was used for a mark or a token or a sign. And that, this is what we're talking about, how the Lord identifies his servant. Let's go, skip over to Exodus, the 13th chapter. We just flip on over a few pages. And we're going to pick this thing up at verses 7 through 9. We're going to read verse 7 through 9, but we're going to show how being under the blood and living not to transgress the law is showing obedience and love toward God. See, when you be obedient to what thus say the Lord, that's showing love. You see, the commandments are love. You know, you hear a lot of people say, well, we ain't under the law, the Old Testament, we under the law of love. It's always been the law of love. Because see, if I love you, I ain't going to steal from you. I ain't going to sleep with your wife. You see what I'm saying? I ain't going to disrespect you. You ain't going to disrespect me. Like the brother say, he said, you know, if we may not be the best of buddies, but we keeping this law, we really ain't got no problem. See what I'm saying? So the law, it's always been about the law of love. But we're going to show how keeping God's law show that you love him. Jesus even prayed in John. He said, I pray not for the world. I pray for them that you have given me, Lord. Talking to the Father. He said, I pray not for the world. I pray for those which you have given me. See what I'm saying? So, but let's go here. Let's go to Exodus 13. And we're going to pick it up as verse 7. And then we're going to read verses 7 through 9. Then we're going to skip down. Okay? And I read. Unleavened bread shall be eaten 7 days. And there shall no leavened bread be seen with thee. Neither shall there be leaven seen with thee in all thy quarters. And thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying, This is done because of what which the Lord did unto me when I came forth out of Egypt. And it shall be for a sign. There it is again. There's that sign. It shall be a sign unto thee upon thy hand and for a memorial between thy eyes. What's between your eyes? Ain't nothing between your eyes but your brain. He said for a memorial and a sign between your what? Between your eyes, a memorial between your eyes, that the Lord's law may be in thy mouth. So now you got something in your brain, so now you're going to start talking. The law going to be in your mouth, okay? And it said, for with a strong hand hath the Lord brought thee out of Egypt. So let's skip down to verse 17. Let's look at what it say. It said, and it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistine, although that was near, for God said, lest peradventure the people repent when they see war and return unto Egypt. See, and that's what he said. See, he know his servant. See, first thing he want this thing to be, you got to keep this thing in your mind. You got to keep this thing always before you. You got to keep that law always before you. You got to be always meditating on his law. You know, I think about yesterday, had some little pagan holiday thing going on at work. And, you know, they were doing, where I work, they do a lot of cooking. And I wasn't just really just thinking about it. But then I told one of the brothers that work in the kitchen, hey, man, put me some of that up. You know, so when lunchtime come, I had something to eat. He said, I got you, T. But then I thought about it. As I was walking out the kitchen, I said, man, that's a Halloween dinner. I can't eat that garbage. That's food sacrifice on the idol. So I turn around and I say, hey, man, don't worry about it. But see what I'm trying to say? That word, that memorial, keeping that law, is going to keep your foot from slipping. That's why you got to keep this thing. Why he said for a memorial between thy eyes. Talking about your brain. He said it's going to be a sign, going to be a mark for you. This is how God marks his servants. Okay? But then in 17 we read, it said, hey, I can't take them this way, because if I take them away to the Philistines, they're going to repent of what I just talked to them. And then they're going to try to go back into Egypt, back into captivity. So God know his servant. So he had to, sometimes you talk to your children. Sometimes you discipline your children with a whooping. Sometimes you guide them in different directions to see, to show them, hey, I got your best interest in heart. God know his people. But let's keep it moving, keep it grooving. Let's go to Leviticus, the chapter 8. Let's go to Leviticus 8. And we're going to pick it up. We're going to pick it up. And all we trying to do in this lesson, we trying to show you, see what I'm saying, how you can know if you marked for life or marked for death. Let's go to Leviticus 8. That's all we trying to show you. Because, you know, you got the pig meat eating preacher, the Sunday preacher tell you, all you got to do is believe. Well, we're going to show you that ain't all you got to do. That ain't all you got to do. And we're going to show that to you. You know what? Let's take a pause for the call. Let's go to Romans. I want to show you something. Because this is where they go to mess a lot of people up. I'm going to change the game up a little bit. That's all right. Let's go to Romans. I want to show you guys something. I want to show you guys something. Now, this is where they always go to try to mess people up. But I'm going to show you something, man. I want to show you something. I'm going to pick it up in Romans chapter 10. And this is where they go to deceive the peoples. But I want to read this to you. And I want you to read this along with me. I'm going to show you if you marked for life or if you marked for death. Look at this, what it say. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. This is where they go. It said, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and shall believe in thine heart, God has raised him from the dead, thou shall be saved. And that's where they stop at, right there. They stop right there. But if they just keep reading, you will know that ain't all you got to do. Look at what verse 10 say. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Verse 11, for the scripture said, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord of all is rich unto all that call upon him. Watch this. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord Jesus of the Lord shall be saved. Watch this. How then can they call on him in whom they have not believed? You don't believe in this, the real, true, and living God in the Bible. Because if you did, you wouldn't be going to church on the first day of the week. You wouldn't be eating pig meat. You wouldn't be celebrating Christmas. You wouldn't be celebrating Halloween. You wouldn't be doing none of these things that's contrary to the word of God. Look what it say. It said, how then shall they call on whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of them of good things. Verse 16, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. Then he, right, look, watch this. For Isaiah said, the Lord, who have believed our report. He just took you back to the Old Testament. You have not all obeyed the gospel. That's why you think you're going to heaven. Your grandmama, your mama, or daddy, they in heaven when they die. That ain't the gospel. That ain't the gospel of the kingdom. Jesus said he's going to set up his kingdom on this earth. But you think you're going to heaven. You think old Rotten Johnny's in hell. You think you ain't got to keep the law. Even Jesus told the rich young ruler. The rich young ruler came to him and said, good master, what must I do to have eternal life? And he told him, point blank, simple rank, keep the commandment. But y'all don't keep the four commandments because y'all going to church on Sunday. Now, you want to live forever with God? Keep the four commandments. Keep all the commandments. Don't eat no pig meat. Don't eat no shrimp. Don't eat no catfish. That's in the book. You ain't obeying the gospel. So, anyway, just wanted to go there real quick like and show you something. How they just try to know. They use the script. They twist it and they catch you up. But anyway, let's go back to Leviticus 8. Leviticus 8, and we're going to read verses 10 through 12. Leviticus 8, 10 through 12, and I read. And Moses took the anointing oil and anointed the tabernacle and all that was therein and sanctified them. And he sprinkled thereof upon the altar seven times. Excuse me, and anointed the altar and all his vessels, Look at what it say now. Both the laver and his foot to sanctify them. Verse 12. And it said, he poured the oil upon Aaron's head and anointed him and sanctified him. What is this oil that he upon? He's sanctifying these vessels and his brother Aaron. This oil is the word of God. Then he said, going to be for memorial in your brain, between your eyes, that when you remember it, it's going to come out your mouth. This is what God is showing you. Always remember, first physical, then spiritual. He's showing you this thing, this oil that sanctifies you, that sets you apart. You consecrated unto the Lord if you keep his word. This ain't hard to understand. See, first, always look at it. First physical, then spiritual. Everything God does is a teaching point. He's showing you how he thinks and how he is. Moving on. He said he took the anointing oil and anointed the tabernacle and all that was therein. He sanctified them and he sprinkled on the altar 7 times. Why 7 times? Because God had given man 7,000 years, and the 7th year is finished. It's over with, and then it's going to be something else. But that's another lesson. You keep watching, we'll show you. And then he said he sanctified Aaron. He poured the oil over Aaron's head and it sanctified him. So this oil, what is this oil? This oil is the word of God that sanctifies. He said to the law and to the testimony. He said they speak not according to these words. He said because there is no light, meaning no understanding in them. Ain't no truth in these guys when they tell you ain't got to do that Old Testament. Ain't no truth in these guys when they say all you need is the New Testament. Or you even got the Hebrews out there saying we don't believe in that new thing. We keep the law. Wherever you stand, the Bible say to the law and to the testimony. He said, bind up the law amongst my disciples. You see what I'm saying? You can go to Isaiah 8 and read it yourself. I ain't tell you no, you don't know. Go over there and read it. You got to have both of them. Matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, it tells you this is the patience of the saints. Them that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Who are the saints? The one that's going to be in the kingdom. You got to have them both. The old book ain't telling you nothing. The new book ain't saying. And the new book ain't confirming nothing that already been said in the old book. But you let your pastor say you ain't got to do all that. You ain't got to keep that old law. He cutting you off. Get your hat and get your coat and get up out of there. He trying to take your crown. And a lot of y'all going to let him do it because he told you. And he told you in Matthew, he said, labor the in at the straight gate. You see what I'm saying? He said, but broad is the path that lead to destruction. And he said, narrow is the path that lead unto salvation. Right? He said, and few that be that fast. So most of y'all just already fulfilling prophecy going on to the lake. I know it don't sound good. It don't sound pleasant, but it is what it is. You don't believe me? Go over there and read. We reading straight book up here. That's all we do. Let's go to Psalms 19. Psalms 19. We still in the old book. Old book still good. Nothing wrong with the old book. Even Peter told you in the New Testament, we have a more sure word of prophecy. Peter even told you that in the new book. He said, we have a more sure word of prophecy. Let's go to Psalms 19. And we're going to pick it up. We're going to pick it up at verse 7. We're going to read verses 7 through 9. You know, And this finna tell you, what the business is with this old book. The law of the Lord is what makes you one wise. You ain't getting no wisdom just read. How you gonna read, get to the end of a book, the New Testament, and know what everything up leading up to that part? And how you gonna tell to do that? You don't get no book. When you're reading the book, you don't get and go to the almost the end or the middle of the book and pick up and start reading. No. You gotta get it all. Look at what it says. Psalms 19, verse 7. The law of the Lord is perfect. So if the law of the Lord is perfect, why would he change that? Why would he get rid of it? But y'all don't know what the book say about, you know what I'm saying, the only law he did away with was the animal sacrifice law, which when he did away with the animal sacrifice law, he got rid of the Levitical priesthood for a minute. Y'all don't know that because y'all don't read the book. But he said the law of the Lord is perfect. So if it's perfect, why would he have to change it? Continue. Converting the soul. So, you know, you hear these people talking about, you know, oh, since I've been converted. Well, you ain't keeping no law. You ain't been converted, not according to the word of God. You ain't been converted because you ain't keeping no law. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure. Then we say to the law, to the testimony, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening eye. The only way you're going to get some understanding, the only way you're going to be enlightened, the only way you're going to get wisdom is through keeping his law, keeping his commandment, his laws, the statutes. If they perfect, if they pure, why would he need to change them? The problem was with the law, the problem was with the people. This is what sets you apart. This is what marks you for life. Continue. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. So, there again, if it's that good, why would he need to change it? Why would he need to do away with it? Continuing on. Let's keep it moving. Let's go over to Proverbs 1. One of my favorite verses of script. Proverbs chapter 1. All right. We're going to read just two verses of script in Proverbs. We're going to read verses 8 and 9. Some heavy hitters. Look at what it say. My son, hear the instruction of thy father. Forsake not the law of thy mother. Watch it. Verse 9. For they shall be an ornament of grace unto thy head and chains about thy neck. Again, an identifier, a sign, a token. Then he said it's going to be for a token. The blood is going to be for a token. This law is going to be for what? It says it's going to be for an ornament. He said it's going to be for an ornament of grace unto thy head. And then it says it's going to be chains about thy neck. Always going to be on your mind. Always going to give you something to hold on to remember this book, this word. That's how God marks his servants. And we're going to keep on reading. We're going to let this book do the talking. Because see, we reading this thing. And I tell y'all, don't look at these videos without your book. Get your book. And you say, hey, Brother T, you messed that up. Y'all know what it is. Hit me up, truehebrew02@gmail.com, or comment on the video on YouTube. You can pull us up all day long, every day. You know what I'm saying? And why I want to take a pause? Well, we're going to keep on going. We'll address that at the end of the video. Now, let's look at some signs. We just looked at how God marks his servant. You know what I'm saying? How he identifies it. Now we're going to look at some signs and marks of the true followers of Christ. And then we're going to also look at some ways you're going to know you ain't a follower of Christ. See what I'm saying? We're going to look at this thing. Let's go. Let's go there. Let's go to the new book. Let's go to Mark chapter 16. You know, let's go to Mark 16. Mark the 16. And we're going to pick it up at verse 17. You got a lot of little one and two hitter quitters. You know, we ain't going to be before you long. We just going to give you, we like to hit you like a Mack truck and keep rolling. Give you something to think about. You know, y'all up in these churches, and even the Bible tell you in Isaiah, he said, why do you spend your money for that which is not bread? You spending all your money, all your time in these churches, and they ain't telling you nothing about the true and living God. You ask an average church goer, hey man, what you learned at church today? Oh, well, I ain't learned nothing. Man, Pastor so-and-so sure did preach. Man, we was jumping off the ceiling, man. We closed it. We shut the parking lot down. We so packed them. What did y'all learn? How much closer are you to becoming born into the God family? They can't tell you. But I can tell you this right here. You come to the IOG, 4485 El Presley Boulevard, Memphis, Tennessee, and we're going to show you how to become God. Because that's what he's been doing the whole time. Because if you can't die and you're in the presence of the Father, what are you? He even told you over in Psalms, he said, are ye not God? Have I not called ye God? He said, he judged among the God. Who is he judging? This book is what's judging you. Excuse me. But anyway, staying on point, let's look at some of the signs and marks of the true followers of Christ And then look at some who are not. And like I said, we're going to Mark the 16. Mark the 16. We're going to read two verses of scripture. We're going to read verses 17 through 18. And this is the Messiah talking. This is Jesus talking. He said, look what he said. He said, and these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils, and they shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. He said, so these signs are going to follow the ones that believe in me. He said, first thing he's going to do, I tell you what, let's read 16. He said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. See, first thing, you got to believe. And like we read on Romans, if you don't know what you believing in, how you know you believing in the right thing? And as far as this baptism, I want to address this baptism real quick, real slick. Check this out. Y'all getting baptized. Y'all baptizing these babies, sprinkling these babies. They ain't got no idea what they doing. That's not biblical. Y'all being baptized and y'all getting baptized under some title. They say they baptize you in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, the name of the Holy. They ain't gave you no name. They ain't gave you no name. And how can you be baptized unless a name be called over you? You see what I'm saying? How can you baptize yourself when somebody got to call a name over you? He set the protocol, go ye baptizing. He didn't say, go ye let yourself be baptized. And then y'all getting baptized in the name, in some titles instead of a name. What is the name they baptizing you in? You just got wet. It ain't no good. You might as well just keep on doing what you were doing. You might as well, like the book say, eat, drink, and be merry, and go on about your business. So number one, you're going to be baptized in the name of Jesus. Because he tell you that. You can go and read over the Gospels and Acts and everything. It'll tell you what the name is. You see what I'm saying? Because the Father's name of Jesus. I know y'all don't know that. Jesus came in his Father's name. The name came from heaven. And then when Jesus got ready to leave, he said, look at him. I'm going to send you a cup, and he's going to come in my name. Well, his name was Jesus. So that's the name you got to get baptized under. But y'all don't know these things because y'all in these Sunday churches and y'all ain't doing no studying. Y'all letting somebody tell you about a personal story reading half a script, if they do that, reading half a script, and then they just telling you about their own personal story. They ain't giving you none of what does say the Lord. But you're going to raise up the dead. You're going to heal the sick. You're even going to take on, you're going to be in some dangerous situation. You're going to take on some two-legged snakes, and they ain't going to be able to hurt you. Because the Lord, the Most High God of Israel, is going to be with you. See what I'm saying? That's one way to identify a true saint. You know what I'm saying? Because the good works and the protection of the Lord is going to be evident in his people. Let's go back to the old book. I told y'all to keep y'all marking Exodus. We're going back to Exodus. We're going to Exodus the 32. We're going to Exodus 32. You know, and we blowing on these YouTube videos. You know what I'm saying? And I know a lot of y'all be, you know, skeptical or whatnot. But that's why I say, go back and get your book. Do some read. And look here. Just don't look at no one video. Check us out. Check us, man. Get this book and check us out and see if we telling you lies. And then take it back in your past and ask him, hey, man, what about this right here? And see what he got to say. I know what he going to tell you. Well, brothers and sisters, some of these things ain't just meant for us to understand. If it wasn't meant for us to understand, it wouldn't be in this book. Do they write books in school, in college, so you cannot understand it? No. He don't know, and he don't want you to know. But I'm going to tell you something else. Some of them Jakes know, and they still don't want you to know. Romans chapter 1, he said, hey, some of them holding the truth in unrighteousness. Even in Jeremiah, he said, they had no, in Isaiah, they said, they don't even pity the people, their own people. Those false prophets, those false pastors, they don't even pity their own people. They plotting and scheming on y'all, thinking how they going to get rich off y'all and how they going to keep rolling, slamming Cadillac doors and Bentley doors, eating high on the hog, and ain't giving y'all nothing. They ain't even giving y'all the keys to the kingdom. They taking your money, they taking your time, and then they ain't giving you nothing for it. They ain't even give you the keys to salvation. And y'all keep on following these false prophets. But that's another lesson. Anyway, let's keep it moving, keep it grooving. 32. We're going to Exodus to 32, and we're going to pick it up at verse 26. We're going to read verses 26 and 28. Like I said, like one or two hit, two verses. And we're going to just, because we ain't trying to keep it long, you know. Exodus 32, 26 through 28, and I read. Now look, this is when the children of Israel had messed up. And look what Moses do. This is when they had made that golden calf and all that. That there. And Moses coming back down the mountain. Look what Moses say. He said, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp. So now can't nobody get past him because he's standing in the gate. Okay. He said, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together. And this got a spiritual meaning too, but it said, all the sons of Levi, meaning all the priests, gathered themselves in front of the gate. So can't nobody get past them. Ain't nobody getting past us. You see what I'm saying? And Moses called everybody and said, who is on the Lord's side? Now look what happened. Look at what happened. It said, and he said unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, put every man his sword by his side. And go in, out from the gate, to the gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and they fell of the people that day about 3,000 men. See, I'm telling you something. And this is going to be a choose up, like we used to say in the street, you got to choose up and lose up. You know what I'm saying? And this is just an inkling, a glimpse of what's going to happen when Jesus get back. Because see, the Bible even tells you, he said in Psalm 110, he said he gonna strike through king and he gonna fill the places with the dead bodies. See, y'all know the real Jesus is Bible. They said the blood gonna be up to the horse's bridle and gonna be for almost 200 miles. And this is the same thing. Moses was a precursor of Jesus. He said, look, who was on the Lord's side? Now, this is God now. And he told him, look, man, I want you to get your sword. And I want you to go through this camp. I want you to kill him. I want you to kill your neighbor, your brother, and anybody else that did this thing. I want you to kill him. See, a right judge is going to execute the judgment no matter how good or bad you think it is. They're going to do what thus say the Lord. He showed you that in Joshua. He told Joshua, look here, man. Don't leave nothing moving. When you go in there, kill everything. He told the same thing to Samuel, but Samuel disobeyed him. He said, hey, man, I want you to kill the mama, the daddy, the children, even the one that's weaning on the breast. I want you to kill him. It's going to be the same thing when Jesus get back. If you ain't on his side, that's why you need to get in this book and find out if you're on his side. Because if you ain't on his side, when he come back, you toasted. You are toast. You finished. It's over with. He going to kill you. Then he going to wake you up. And then he going to throw you in the lake of fire. Keep it moving. Keep it moving. Revelation chapter 7. God's servants will be seen. Revelation the 7th. Go to the last book of the Bible. Go to chapter 7. Because God's servants will be sealed. Revelation the 7th. We're going to read verses 1 through 3. Revelation the 7th. We're going to read verses 1 through 3. And I read. And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, and behold, the four winds of the earth, and that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another great angel. I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. Look at that. You got an angel that's holding back the wind. Then you got another angel, he got a seal in his hand. And we're going to read that in the evening old. Like we said, we do the law and the testimony. In the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every matter be established. Having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea. Now, God's going to give these angels the word to wreak havoc on this earth. But first, he going to seal his servant. Check out what it say, verse 3. Saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the tree, till we have sealed the servants of God in their foreheads. And we ain't going to read all this here in the 7, but we're going to be flip-flopping, you know what I'm saying? And we're going to show you some other things. We're going to show you, but he said, hey, don't do nothing until I seal the servants of God in their foreheads. Now check this out. He done this before, but check this out. We're going to the old book. Let's go to Ezekiel, Brother Zeke. Let's go to Ezekiel, the chapter 9, and see what the Most High had Ezekiel to write. Ezekiel 9. We're going to read verses 1 through 6. Then we're going to skip down. See what I'm saying? We're going to skip down to verse 9. But I'm going to read this verses 1 through 6. Check this out. And this is about the slaughter of these people that do idolatry. You ones that got that cross hanging around your neck. The ones hanging out your ear and on your purse and tattooed on your body. That's idolatry. You see what I'm saying? Matter of fact, do me a favor. The next time you sitting there with your iPhone or your Samsung, Note, Galaxy, whatever. Just go in there and Google or ask Siri, what is the Roman death symbol? And watch what come up. It's going to be the cross. If you think I'm lying, try it. Say, what is the Roman death symbol? And the cross is going to come up. And you think you're doing something holy. And they crucified the Messiah on that cross. Matter of fact, he can tell you, curses everyone that hangeth off a tree. But you walk around like you so holy in the now. And you got your pastor wearing him and all this old garbage. Man, that's some garbage. See, he finna deal with these idolaters right here. Look at what it say. Verse 1 and I read. Ezekiel 9, verses 1 through 6. And he cried also in my ear with a loud voice saying, call them that have charge over the city to draw near. Every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. Then we keep reading about these jokes with these destroying weapons. Now, these men right here ain't men, literal men. These are angels. We don't read that now. I'm going to show you. God, he will do you. He will do you now. But check it though. And behold, 6 men came from the way of the high gate. Now, they're gated again. They're standing at the gates now. Which lie toward the north. And every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with linen, with a writer's ink horn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub. See, these are cherubim, these are angels. Whereupon he was to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with white linen, which had the writer's ink horn by his side. Verse 4. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city. Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst of. He said, hey, man, go down there, mark all these jokers that's vexed in their spirit, that's sighing and crying about all these abominations that's being done in the holy city. He said, go down and mark them, man. He said, verse 5. And to the others, he said, in mine hearing, go after him through the city and smite. Let your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon who is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. So, hey, all y'all people. It keeps saying, I love the Lord, and this, that, and the third, and talking about, I've been walking with the Lord for 50, 40 years. Y'all better check yourself. Better check your pig meeting pastor, because I'm telling you, he said, begin at my sanctuary. And he said, spare not. Kids, mamas, grandmamas, grandpapas, pawpaw, maw, me, maw, and everybody else, I'm coming to get you if you ain't got this seed. See, this is the true and living God in the book. Now, we just read that in the Old Testament. Now, we're reading it. We read the New Testament. Now, we're reading it old. Where I leave off at. Let's skip down. We read through verse 6, right? Well, I ain't finished reading. Then they began at the ancient men, meaning the old men, which were before the house. And let's skip down to verse 9. For the sake of time, we're going to skip down to verse 9. Look at what it says. Then said he unto me, the iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood, and the city full of perverseness. And they say, the Lord has forsaken the earth, and the Lord see it not. And they doing it now. Everywhere you look, I don't care if it's Memphis, New York, California, across that water, it's the cities are full of blood. And they say it in their mind, hey, the Lord and forsake us, we might as well do what we want to do, because he don't see nothing. But hey, he said, hey, it's just for a set time. The Bible said the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as men count slack. He's just an appointed of time. And hey, he told you today, hey, the prophecy and everything, that's sure, it's going to happen. The interpretation of it is sure. He just set a time. That's all it is. And he said, hey, but they say the Lord see it not. Verse 10. And as for me, also my eyes shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their head. So, hey, you setting yourself up for the key. Man, look, I'm going to tell you like this here. This thing is deadly serious. Your eternal salvation is on the line. Why not do a little research just to see if your pastor and what you've been taught growing up is real? This thing ain't serious. Why not invest a little time in just to see, hey man, is this brother full of bull or is he not? Is my pastor full of bull or is he not? Did Big Mama and Paw lie to me? Did they not know anything because they pastor was lying? Let me go research just a little bit. Just to see if this thing is real. Because your eternal salvation is on the line, man. He said, God said, I ain't going to have no pity. I'm coming through. And I'm wrecking shop. And I ain't sparing nobody. If you ain't sealed with the seal or the mark of God, then you sealed and you marked for death. Continue. Back to Revelation chapter 9. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. And we're going to read down through verse 4. And we ain't got time to read everything on this here because we got some more scripts we try to get to. But we're going to read this thing here right here, though. Got to read this part. Revelation 9. Verses 1 through 4, and I read. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by the reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and upon them were given power as scorpions over the earth. I'm sorry. And unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither the green, any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their forehead. And we ain't got time to show you everything. These are war weapons. And other lessons, we show you what this is. But he said, hey, the only one they gonna hurt is the ones don't have the seal of God in their forehead. Don't have that knowledge. Don't have that understanding. See what I'm saying? You got to have some knowledge and understanding to be marked for life. But they tell you saved by grace. Well, how you know you sealed until that day of redemption? If you ain't got to do nothing, just call on the name of Jesus and believe. The demons know who Jesus is. Then they tell you, hey, man, we know who you are. Well, have you come to torment us before our time? And they still demons. They ain't going to be in the kingdom. Excuse me, not the good side anyway. They're going to be in the lake of fire. So you letting your pastor tell you all you got to do is believe and call on his name. They said, we know who thou art, O son of God. But you think they going to be in the kingdom because they knew who he was and called his name? No. Better get you some understanding. Check the past, man. Check everything you believe in against this book. Because if you don't, it's on you. It's on you. He said he going to, then we read at the beginning of this thing, he going to reward every man according to their work shall be. See, he said, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their forehead. Keeping it moving. Let's go to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. You know what I'm saying? We're going to read verses 19. We're going to read verses 19 through 21. 2 Timothy 2, verses 19 through 21, and I read. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. Now that seal is, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. What? Look up the word iniquity in your concordance. It means lawlessness. Lawlessness. So when you, what is lawlessness? It is sin. What is sin? 1 John chapter 3, verse 4 said, for sin is the transgression of the law. So without no law, there could be no sin. So the only way you can define sin is you go against the law, go against the commandments. But you would know that if you went in that Sunday church. Verse 20. But in a great house, there are not only vessels of silver, see what I'm saying, and vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and of earth, some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, shall he be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Unto every good work, you got to purge yourself from these things. From this, you got to keep the law. Because then he said, depart from iniquity would mean lawlessness. He said, but in a great house there are vessels of gold and silver, also of wood and earth, some to honor and some to dishonor. He said, but if a man purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. This is how you sanctify yourself. But you let them tell you, you ain't got to keep no law. So how can you be sanctified? Then the Bible say, we read in Psalm, it converts, it sanctifies, it sets you apart. The law, the commandments. See, I told you, whatever you read in the old, you're going to read in the new. Continue. Ephesians chapter 4. Got these jokers running right here telling you ain't got to keep no law. And they sending you straight to the lake of fire where they are headed. Y'all better get y'all some understanding, get y'all some knowledge, some wisdom. Stop believing what folks tell you and get in this book and study to show yourself approved. Ephesians the 4. Verses 29 through 30. Two verses of script. Listen what it says. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of the edifying, that they may minister grace unto the hearers. Now you say you got to administer grace. How are you administering grace? Because y'all don't know what grace is. See, that's what I'm saying. But we got lessons on that. Go back and look at it. We got lessons called grace, what is it really? Show you what grace really is. He said, but let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good unto the use of edifying, meaning educating, giving the people some substance, not just believe. that they may minister grace unto the hearers, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. See, you got to be sealed unto the day of redemption. That's why he said, he that endureth unto the end, the same shall be saved. You ain't saved when you come into the saving grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. You got to endure this thing to the end. He said, unto the what? To the day of redemption. He said, he that endureth to the end. Jesus even told you over there, I think it's Matthew, he told you four times. He said, all that the Father give me, I will raise it up in the last day. But y'all say soon your mama died. That's not Sister Joan there. That's just her shell. She done made her home going. No, she ain't. When they put her in that ground, then she done made her home come because she didn't come from earth. I mean, she didn't come from heaven. She came from the earth. So how can she make a home going if she ain't never been there? It ain't never been her home. Why would God put all this time, effort, and energy into making this earth and then just take you up? He just could have made you and put you up there where he was. But he put you here. And he said, dust thou art and dust thou shalt return. And like I said, Jesus told you over there, I think in Matthew, he said, all that the Father give me, he going to raise it up in the last day. So that's, like I say, better check what you believe. Let's go. Let's go here. Let's go here. Let's go to Romans, the 16. Romans, the 16. Flip back a few books. Romans, the 16. And we making good time. We're going to make a good time. And then, you know, we're going to finish show you that, hey, if you're not serving the Lord, who are you serving? Romans 16. We're going to read two verses of script, 17 through 18. Look at what it says. He said, now, I beseech ye, brethren, mark them which call divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. He said, mark them. Point them out. Put them on Front Street. He said, when you find out who they are, stay away from them. See, you mark for death then. Because, see, you're doing something contrary to the doctrine of God. See, Creflo, Cashflo Dollar, TD Snakes, Eddie Thorne, you teaching contrary to the doctrine of this book. And he said, mark those that call the vid. He said, and stay away from them. So y'all folks that's following these jackleg preachers, these Sunday worshipers, these Sunday goers, he said, hey, you better stay away from them. Because they ain't giving you this doctrine. See what I'm saying? They giving you the doctrine that they got from Papa over there. That's who gave you Sunday. You know, S-U-N, the sun worship. Why you think he be walking around holding that little thing with the sun on him when you see him? See? Think about it. Verse 18. For they are such serve not the Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, by good words and fair speeches, deceive the hearts of the simple. So now that ain't my opinion. God called you simple. He said, you know, y'all going along with them good words and fair speeches, but he ain't give you no doctrine. He ain't give you no word. And the Lord called you simple. Over there, even in Proverbs, he said, how long will you simple one will you love simplicity? And get what else he said? He said, and fools hate knowledge. That ain't my word. You go read Proverbs chapter 1, verse 22. Read it. It's in there. And he just called you what? He called you simple again. You basic. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got no intellect, very little intellect, because he said you simple. He said, deceive the hearts, meaning the minds of the simple, with fair speeches and good words. The Lord love you regardless, baby. Come to the Lord as you are. No. Can't come to the Lord as you are. Hey, that's big lie told. You either gonna worship him his way or it ain't gonna be accepted. Now you can take it for what you were. I'm giving it to you 100. That's why he said they have not all obeyed the gospel. That's why I read that to you. Romans 6. We still in Romans. Go over to did I finish that? Now I gotta read verse 18. No, I read that. We read. Let's go to Romans 6. There's one verse of script here. Romans 6. And we're going to read one verse. We're going to read verse 16. Look at what it say. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or obedience unto righteousness. Now then look what it say. Know ye not that whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey. Are you obeying this book? You still got to obey something. You got to obey. You just can't just say, I believe in Jesus Christ and I'm saved. You got to obey something. What you obeying? You know, brother say, they tell you the law done away with. I said, was that right? You know, I said, well, the law done away with. Look here, man. Man, your wife fine. And man, she sure got a round mound on her. I sure like sleep with your wife. He said, man, you can't do that. I said, why? Because that's adultery. I said, no, that's the law. Thou shalt not. You know, you got that big 55-inch flat screen TV up in that joint. You know, you watching NFL Sunday Ticking, this, that, and the third. I said, hey, man, you walk in your house, you see me with your TV up under my arm going out your door. He said, hey, man, what you doing? I said, well, man, you know, hey, man, this everything fair game. You know, he said, man, you can't do that. I said, why? He said, that's stealing. I said, no, that's the law. So, y'all say the law done away with, but then as soon as somebody do something wrong, you say you can't do it. Say, well, ain't no rules. You can throw out the rules. I can do what I want to do. I can sleep with your wife. I can take your money, steal your car. I can do whatever I want. Y'all say, hey, man, the law done away with. So ask your pastor, hey, man, can I sleep with your old lady? You know what he going to say? No. You going to say, why? He going to say, that's adultery. You turn around and tell him just like I told you, no, that's the law. Keeping it moving. Revelation 9. See what I'm saying? Revelation. Let's go back to the book of Revelation. Revelation 9. You hear me? Revelation 9. We're going to pick it up. We're going to pick it back up at verse. Because we stopped. See what I'm saying? We stopped it. We're going to pick it back up at 4. We're going to read verses 4 through 6. We're going to get this thing again. Said, and it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their forehead. And it said, and to them was given that they should not kill them, but they should torment them 5 months. And their torment was the torment of a scorpion when it striketh a man. And in those days, men shall seek death and shall not find it. They shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. So once again, you know, just want to bring this thing home. Excuse me. They want to bring this thing home on what's really going on here. See what I'm saying? And hey, it's going to be a terrible thing to be looking for death and can't find it. It's a terrible thing to want to die and can't die. And we got other lessons to deal with this in more detail. But I'm just hitting these high points that, hey, if you ain't marked for life, then you got some drama coming in your world. You got some straight drama coming. You see what I'm saying? Skip down to verse 11. Let's read that. We'll look what it say. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. Who is that? We finna find out. Whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon. But in the Greek tongue, his name is Apollyon, both of them which mean destroyer. Who will destroy you? Satan the devil. This is going to be your king over you, and this is what you got coming. Just a little taste of the basin, I can say, till you get thrown in that lake. Then you finish forever. And I know what y'all saying, man, Brother T, man, you always trying to scare. Yeah, I'm trying to scare you. Trying to scare some sense in you. I am trying to scare you. Trying to scare you enough where you're getting this book and read it for yourself and get some understanding for yourself and stop letting Patha tell you everything. Get you some truth and some knowledge of who you're dealing with. Because when you find out who you're dealing with, you find out that this cat ain't nobody to play with. This God of this Bible ain't nothing to play with. He will do you. Moving on. Staying in Revelation. Let's go to Revelation the 13th. Revelation the 13th, we're going to read verses 16 through 17. Revelation 13, verses 16 through 17, and I read. And he calls all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand and or in their forehead, and that no man might buy or sell, say they had the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. So now, this is during the great tribulation period. We ain't going to go into all that. But hey, you take this mark, though, you finished. And it's going to be a hard thing to y'all who ain't got no knowledge. It's going to be an easy thing for y'all who ain't got no knowledge to do. But it's going to be yet even some with the knowledge of God that's going to take this mark. And you finish when you take that mark. Ain't no coming back from that mark. Ain't no forgiveness of that mark. You know what I'm saying? It's going to be a hard thing when you standing there and baby girl or your son or your wife and daughter need something to eat. It's dead winter, ain't no heat on. And you, the only way you're going to get some food or get some heat on is you take that mark. But when you take that mark, understand you got one thing and one thing only coming. The lake of fire. It's going to be a hard thing when you standing there, somebody got a gun in your head and they got your baby daughter, your baby son, or your wife or your husband say, hey, man, if you don't take this mark, we're going to blow their brains out. What you going to do? Some of y'all gonna crack and fold under the pressure. Cause y'all and y'all, you ain't taught you brothers out there, you ain't taught your family what does say the Lord. And this thing gonna come up on you suddenly. And y'all gonna crack and fold under the pressure. And you gonna end up taking that mark. Hear me now. You end up taking that mark. And you gonna damn your soul to the lake of fire. This what the book tell. This what the book teach. This ain't my word. You go in and read it yourself. Go to Revelation the 19th chapter. Revelation the 19th. We're going to read two verses of scripture. I thought I got a lot of one and two hitters. Revelation 19. And we're going to read verses 19 through 20. Look at what it says. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on a horse and against his army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, and them that worshiped his image. These were cast alive into the lake burning with fire and brimstone. I'm going to read verse 21. And the remnant was slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which the sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls of the air were filled with their flesh. Let me tell you something. Like I just got you saying, take that mark if you want to. But see, when you ain't got no understanding, you ain't got no knowledge, you think, hey, man, I'm just trying to provide for my family, man. I got to do what I got to do so we can eat, man. Hey, man, I'm telling you, don't do it. Don't do it. Because if you do it, hey, it's on you, and you ain't got, we just read, you take that mark, you been deceived, see what I'm saying? Then, hey, man, you going to the lake of fire with the devil, with the false prophet and the beast. Y'all all going to be in there together. Continue. See, and this is what I was telling y'all earlier in the lesson, that the saints keep the law and the testimony. They keep the old and the new. Watch what I tell you. Told you, I don't never tell you nothing I can't read out this book. Let's go to Revelations. Now, we just heard what's going to happen to the one that take that mark, where they going. But let's look at the one that's been sealed by God. Let's go to Revelation the 14th. Let's go to Revelation the 14th. And we're going to read verses 9 through 12. Revelation the 14th. And we're going to read verses 9. Is that right? Yeah, verses 9 through 12, and I read. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worships the beast and his image and receives his mark in their forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture. You heard it right. It said, into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and with brimstone, in the presence of the holy angel. So they're going to be over there watching y'all. And in the presence of the Lamb. Who is the Lamb? The Lamb is Jesus. And yeah, you're going to be tormented with fire and brimstone in their presence. So I said, the good side of the king, the bad side of the king, the lake of fire going to be in the kingdom too. Now, we read it now. Okay? And we can read another scripture to prove that. That's another lesson. Verse 11. And the smoke of their torment ascended up forever and ever. And they have no rest, rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image. And whoever so receiveth the mark of his name. Look at what verse 12 say. Here is the patience of the saints. Stop. Who are the saints? The one that's going to be in the kingdom. You ain't got to be no rocket science to even know that. You ain't got to be no Bible scholar to know that the saints, they call you a saint. If you're going to be in the presence of God, you're going to be in the kingdom. Okay, he said, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Here we are in the last book of the Bible, still talking about keeping the commandments. He said, these are the ones. These are the saints, the ones that keep the commandments. And have the testimony of Jesus. I told you, you got to have both of them. You got to have the old and you got to have the new. Now ask your pastor to explain that to you. Ask him to explain. I dare you to ask him to explain that scripture, that one verse of scripture. Tell him, look, take pastor, let's go to Revelation 14. We're going to read one verse. Let's read verse 12 and tell him to explain that to you. Why is he still talking about keeping the commandment in the very last book of the Old Testament, of the New Testament? Why? If the commandment has been done away with. He just showed you in these three verses of scripture, the one that took the mark of Satan the devil, and the one who's been marked by God. Remember we read about that thing in your mind that's coming out your mouth, keeping that law? Three more verses of scripture. Let's go to Matthew. And we read most of this out of the New Testament, are we not? Let's go to Matthew 25. Matthew 25. We're going to read verses 31. You know what I'm saying? We're going to read 31 through 34. Matthew 25. 31 through 34, and I read. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory. It's talking about when Jesus come back and all the holy angels with him. Well, if he's taking y'all to heaven, why he got to come back? Again, check your pastor. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another as a shepherd divided his sheep from the goats. That's another lesson. And he shall set the sheep on the right hand, but the goats on the left. There it is again. He's separating somebody. He's showing something. He said he's sanctifying. He said, then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So this kingdom been prepared for us from the foundation of the world. What world? The earth. He's setting it up here. You ain't going there. They say he coming. He said, then he said he separate all the nations, the nationalities, and he set the good ones on the right, the sheep on the right, and the goats on the left. And he said to the sheep, come and enjoy this kingdom that will prepare you from the foundation of the world. Check your pastor. Check what you believe. Check what you've been told. Read this book. Continue. Matthew 12, flip back. You marred for life or you marred for death. One of the two. Ain't no in between. Matthew 12, verse 47 through 50. Matthew 12, 47 through 50. And I read. Then one said unto him, behold thy mother. Well, let's read 46 to get the whole full understanding. While he yet talked to the people, behold his mother and his brethren stood without desiring to speak to him. Then one said unto him, Behold, thy mother and thy brethren stand without desiring to speak with thee. Look at what Jesus told him. But he answered and said unto them that told him, Who is my mother and who is my brethren? And he stretched forth his hand toward his disciples and said, Listen what the master said now. He said, Behold, my mother and my brethren. Verse 50, For whosoever shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same is my mother, my sister. The same is my brother, my sister, and my mother. See, I'm keeping 100 with you. I know we got all our family. We love our loved ones. We just like anybody else. We love our loved ones. But he said, the ones that do the will of my Father, them the only ones he knows is his family. Now, did I say that? Or did we read that? That's Jesus right there saying that. They say, hey, man, your mama and your brother's out there looking for you. He said, hey, man, who is my mother and who is my brother? He said, those that do the will of my Father, they are my family. So, you got a problem with it? You got a problem with Jesus. But you say you love Jesus. But you just read it. It's in red writing. I ain't got to say nothing else on that. Last verse of script. We're going to close it out. Let's go to the last book of the Old Testament. Malachi. Let's go see what Malachi Mal got to say about the situation. Malachi 3. And we're going to read verses 16 through 17. Just two more verses of script. Look, same thing we've been reading. Look at what it say. Verse 16, and I read. Then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name, and they shall be mine, said the Lord of hosts, in that day. What day? The day when the Lord come back and set up shop on his earth, in that 1,000-year reign, in that day of rest. But see, y'all don't know nothing about that because y'all don't read this book. But that's another lesson. When I make up my jewels, I will spare them as a man that spares his own son and that serveth him. So, hey, man. That is right there. He said he going to, that we just read about him setting the sheep and the goats, separating the sheep and the goat. He said, hey, now he's likening it to jewels. When he get back, you know what I'm saying? He gonna make up his jewel. And he going to spare them, the ones that have been marred for life. See what I'm saying? So y'all need to check y'all pastor, man. Go back and read these scripts and see if I'm telling you something out of my own mind, of my own mouth, or we reading what does say the Lord. See what I'm saying? So that's the lesson. Marred for life or marred for death. Hey, man, to my brothers and sisters in the faith, I salute you. Hey, keep looking at these videos. If you got any questions, hit us up. Hey, we got people from all over the world looking at this channel now. And I ain't lying when I say all over the world. We got folks in Ireland, down in the island, here in the United States. They looking at these videos and we welcome y'all questions. Hit us up, man, on the Gmail account, truehebrew02@gmail.com, or reply on the video. We'll get back to you as soon as possible. Hey, the Young Lion going to be back in effect in the next couple of weeks. We coming at you with both barrels wide open. We're going to give you the uncut word of God. We appreciate it. Man, we got thousands of views. I mean, we over 14,000 views now, man. So, hey, keep on looking at these videos. You got any questions, get at us. All praise, honor, glory due to the Most High God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Israel. Brothers and sisters, we love y'all. We keeping it 100. We're going to always do that. This your boy, T-Boogie. I'm going to get back at you.